Lecture number 9 on subject atomic physics. SEMs, multi-electron atoms, ground states and X-ray excitations. Before studying multi-electron atoms, we must discuss an important topic of quantum mechanics that does not enter into the theory of the one-electron atoms. This concerns the question of how to give an accurate quantum mechanical description of a system containing two or more identical particles, such as electrons. Discussing this question will lead us to quantum mechanical phenomena that have absolutely no classical analogies. In fact, the discussion will bring out some of the most striking differences between classical and quantum mechanics. The nature of the question can best be illustrated by a specific example. Consider a box containing two electrons. These two identical particles move around in the box, bouncing from the walls and occasionally scattering from each other. In a classical description of the system, the electrons travel in sharply defined trajectories so that constant observation of the system allows us to distinguish between the two electrons, even so they are identical particles. For instance, in classical physics, we can follow the development of this system without disturbing it by taking motion pictures on the system. If on a certain frame of the film we label the image of the one of the electron 1 and label the image of the other electron 2, we can follow the motion of the electrons through subsequent frames and always be able to say which electron is 1 and which electron is 2. The pressure is indicated in figure 1. Of course, we cannot label the electrons themselves any more than we can paint one red and other green. Electrons are identical particles. Any electron is exactly the same as any other electron. Nevertheless, in classical physics, identical particles can be distinguished from each other by procedures which do not otherwise affect their behavior, and so it's possible to assign labels to the particles. In quantum mechanics, this cannot be done because the uncertainty principle does not allow us to observe constantly the motion of the electrons without changing other behavior. As we have seen earlier, the photons which we must use to illuminate the scene for the motion picture camera interact with the electrons in a significant and unpredictable manner. The behavior of the electrons is seriously affected by any attempt to distinguish them. Figure 1. An equivalent but more formal statement in that is quantum mechanics, the finite extent of the wave functions associated with each electron may lead to an overlapping of these wave functions that makes it difficult to tell which wave function was associated with each electron. A good example is provided by the helium atom. The wave functions of the two electrons overlap highly in all quantum states, and so the electron cannot be distinguished. There is also an overlap of the wave functions associated with the electron and the proton of a hydrogen atom. But this does not lead to any problems in distinguishing one particle from the other, because an electron and proton are not identical. They can be distinguished by the differences on their mass, charge, etc. We see that there is a fundamental distinction between the classical and quantum mechanical description of the system containing identical particles. An accurate quantum mechanical treatment of the systems must be formulated in such a way that the indistinguishability of identical particles is explicitly taken into account. That is, measurable results obtained from accurate quantum mechanical calculations should not depend on the assignment of labels to identical particles. This property leads to important effects which have no classical analogies, because indistinguishability itself is purely quantum mechanical. Since it is the eigenfunctions that carry the burden of the describing quantum mechanical systems, we must look for a way of writing them so that they contain a mathematical expression of the qualitative ideas developed above. We continue considering two identical particles, e.g. two electrons or two protons or the two particles or two helium atoms in a box. To simplify the argument, we assume that we can neglect the interactions between the particles. Then they will be bonds between the walls of the box, but they will not scatter from each other. Despite the simplification, the results of the following discussion are of quite general validity. The time-independent Schrödinger equation for our system of two non-interacting particles in three dimensions can be written. Formula 1. Where m, the mass of either particle, x sub 1, y sub 1, z sub 1, the coordinates of particle 1, x sub 2, y sub 2, z sub 2, the coordinates of particle 2. This equation can be obtained immediately by writing the classical expression for the total energy of the system, replacing the dynamical quantities for the associated quantum mechanical operators to obtain the Schrödinger equation, and then separating out the time dependence. Since the pressure is a simple extension of that used to obtain the time-independent Schrödinger equation for one particle in three dimensions, and since the validity of Formula 1 is quite obvious or anyway, we shall not include the details here. It is more important to point out that Formula 1 does use labels which specify the identity of the two particles S1 and 2. In the time-independent Schrödinger equation, Formula 1, psi sub t function from x sub 1, that's sub 2, the eigenfunction of the total system, V sub t function, the potential energy for the total system, E sub t, the total energy for the total system. Since we have assumed that there is no interaction between the two particles, the particles move independently. The potential energy of the total system is then simply the sum of the potential energies of each particle in its interaction with the all walls of the box. Each potential energy will depend only on the coordinates of one particle, and since the particles are identical, the two potential energy functions are the same. Thus, V sub t functions equal V x sub 1, y sub 1, z sub 1 functions plus V x sub 2, y sub 2, z sub 2 function. Formula 2. It is easy to show by applying the technique of separation of variables that for the potential of 2 formula, there are solutions of 2 first formula of the form C sub 2 sub t functions. Formula 3. Where C function of x sub 1, y sub 1, z sub 1, and psi function x sub 2, y sub 2, z sub 2 satisfy identical one particle time independent Schrödinger equations. Note that the total eigenfunction is written as a product of the two eigenfunctions describing the independently moving particles. Each of the eigenfunctions describing one of the particles requires three quantum numbers to specify the mathematical form of its dependence of its three space coordinates. In addition, each requires one more quantum number to specify the orientation of the spin of the particle. We shall shorten the notation by using a single symbol, such as alpha or beta or gamma, to designate a particular set of the four quantum numbers required to specify the space and spin quantum state of one of the particles. Thus, alpha, for example, stands for a certain set of values of the four quantum numbers. Then alpha particle eigenfunction for particle 1 will be written. C sub alpha function from x sub 2, y sub 2, z sub 2. We'll shorten the notation by writing as psi sub alpha from function from 1. This Eigen function contains the information that particle 1 is in the space and spin quantum states described by alpha. Numerically, it is the function of the form specified by psi sub alpha evaluated at the coordinates of particle 1. An Eigen function indicating that particle 2 is in the space and spin quantum state beta will be written psi sub beta from function from 2. The total Eigen function psi sub t equals psi sub alpha from 1 multiplied psi sub beta from 2 for the case of which particle 1 is in the state alpha and particle 2 is in the state beta is psi t function formula 4. An Eigen function indicating that particle 1 is in the state beta and particle 2 is in the state alpha has the quantum number symbols interchanged, formula 5. Now let us see whether measurable quantities evaluated from these total Eigen functions depend on the assignment of the particle labels. The simplest measurable is the probability density function. For the Eigen function of 4, it is formula 6, and for the Eigen function of 5, it is formula 7. Since the two identical particles are indistinguishable, we should be able to exchange their labels without changing a measurable quantity such as the probability density. As an example, we carry out this operation on formula 6 obtaining next formula, where the arrows mean that the expression of the left changes into the expression on the right when 1 changes into 2 and 2 changes into 1. But it is apparent that the labeled probability density function is not equal to the original probability density function. For instance, the first term in the labeled function expression on the right is psi sub alpha evaluated at the coordinates x sub 2, y sub 2, z sub 2, while the first term in the original function expression on the left is psi sub alpha evaluated at the coordinates x sub 1, y sub 1, z sub 1. Thus, a relabeling of the particles actually does change the probability density function calculated from the Eigen function of formula 4. The same is true for the Eigen function of formula 5. Therefore, we must conclude that these are not acceptable Eigen functions for the accurate description of a system containing two identical particles. The suspension with the expression after writing the time-independent Schrödinger equation 1 has been justified. It is, however, possible to construct an Eigen function which satisfies the time-independent Schrödinger equation and yet has the acceptable property that its probability density function is not changed by a relabeling of the particles. In fact, there are two ways of doing this. Consider the following two linear combinations of the Eigen functions for formula 4 and formula 5, next formula 8 and formula 9. The first is called a symmetric total Eigen function, and the second the anti-symmetric total Eigen function, for reasons that will become apparent soon. Now, the total energy of a system containing alpha particle in a quantum state A and another particle in the quantum state beta will not depend on which particle is in which state, if the particles are identical. Thus, both psi sub 2 sub t equals psi sub alpha function 1 multiply psi sub beta function 2 and psi sub t equals psi sub beta function 1 multiply psi sub alpha function 2 are solutions to the time independent Schrödinger equation's first formula corresponding to the same value of the total energy E sub t. Because that equation is linear in psi sub t, it follows immediately that the linear combinations psi sub alpha and psi sub beta of the two forms of psi sub t are also solutions, since they correspond to the same value of psi sub e sub t. They are degenerate solutions, that is, psi sub s and psi sub a are different eigen functions corresponding to precisely the same eigen value. The phenomenon is called exchange degeneracy, since the difference between the degenerate eigen functions has to do with exchange of the particle labels. The factor of 1 divided square root 2 ensures that psi sub s and psi sub a will be normalized if psi sub t equals psi sub alpha from function 1, multiply psi sub beta function 2, and psi t equals psi sub beta function 1, multiply psi sub alpha function 2 are normalized. It is easy to evaluate the probability density functions for psi sub s and psi sub a and then show that in both cases their values are not changed by a change of the particle labels. We shall obtain this result by investigating the effect of an exchange of the particle labels on the eigen functions themselves. Carry out the operation, we have psi sub s equals formal number 10 and psi sub a formal number 11. We see that the symmetric total eigen function psi sub s is unchanged by an exchange of the particle labels, and that the antisymmetric total eigen function psi sub a is multiplied by minus 1 by an exchange of the particle labels. These properties give rise to their names. Well, we then have for the probability densities formula 12 and formula 13. Hence, for the both of the symmetric and antisymmetric total eigen functions, the probability density functions are not changed by exchange of the particle labels. The change in sign of the antisymmetric eigen function under an exchange of the particle labels is, of course, not objectionable, since an eigen function itself is not measurable. It can be shown that any measurable quantity that can be obtained from the symmetric or antisymmetric total eigen function is not affected by an exchange of the particle labels. Thus, these two eigen functions provide an accurate description of a system containing two identical particles. Also, the labels 1 and 2 do appear in the expressions for psi sub s and psi sub a. This labeling does not violate the requirements of the indistinguishability, because the value of the any measurable quantity obtained from the eigen functions is independent of the assignment of the labels. Example 1. Two identical particles move independently in a one-dimensional box of length a, one being in the ground state of the infinite square with potential describing the box, and the other being in the first excited state of that potential. For simplicity, assume that the particles have not no spin, so that the total eigen functions for the system are just space eigen functions a. Evaluating the symmetric and antisymmetric total eigen functions of formula 8 and formula 9 and verify that the factor 1 divided square root 2 in these equations does properly normalize them. Using the general forms for the eigen function for one particle is an infinite square well potential, and also using the normalization constant evaluated in example 10 from lecture 5, we find that the normalized space eigen function of the particle in the ground state is square root from square root 2 divided a multiplied cosine p multiplied x divided a, and the normalized space in eigen function for the particle in the first excited state is square root 2 divided a multiplied sine 2 multiplied p multiplied x divided a. Thus, writing the Semitic and anti-Semitic space eigen functions for the two particle system as psi sub plus and psi sub minus, we have from 8 and 9 formulas. Next formulas. When both x sub 1 and x sub 2 lead within the range minus a divided 2 to a divided 2. When either x sub 1 or the x sub 2 lie outside that range, both x sub plus and x sub minus are zero since the one particle eigen functions have zero value there. The normalization integral for psi sub plus is next integral. Now each of the first two terms in the bracket wields one since in each both integrals are just the normalization integrals for the normalized one particle eigen functions. Square root 2 divided a cosine p multiplied x divided a and square root 2 divided a multiplied sine 2 multiplied p multiplied x divided a. Furthermore, each of the last two terms in the bracket yields zero since both are the product of two integrals of the form and value. Next integral. The value can be verified in any table of defined integrals. Thus, the normalization integral for c sub plus yields 1 half multiplied 1 plus 1, where the 1 half came from squaring the factor 1 divided square root 2 in 8 formula. So we find that the factor does properly normalize c sub plus by making its normalization integral equal 1. We can also immediately show that the same conclusion is obtained for psi sub minus. Inspection for the table of definite integrals will further show that the integral from minus a divided 2 to a divided 2 of any two different sinusoidal eigen functions for a particle in an infinite square well potential has the value 0. In fact, it can be proven from general considerations that the integral over all x of any two different eigen functions of any particular potential has the value 0. This property is called orthogonality. Because of the orthogonality of one particle eigen functions only two power terms in the normalization integral, for any symmetric or anti-symmetric two-particle eigen function have non-zero values. And because of the normalization of one-particle eigen functions, those two values are both equal to 1. Therefore, the factor 1 divided square root 2 in 8 and 9 formulas ensures that these total eigen functions are normalized in all cases. B. Write expressions for the expectation value of the separation distance d between the particles for the case in which the space eigen function for the two particle system is symmetric and for the case in which it is antisymmetric. Then show that in neither of their cases is this expectation value affected by an exchange of the particle labels. The separation d, distance d, is the absolute value of the difference in their x coordinates. That is, d equals absolutely from x sub 2 minus x sub 1 equals absolutely from x sub 1 minus x sub 2. The expectation value d is was case of the psi sub plus equals next formula. Similarly, for the case of psi sub minus, d equals next formula. Some work will be required to evaluate the integrals for these two cases, but we can see immediately that in both the values are not affected by exchanging of the particle labels. The reason is that in both integrals, neither the factor x sub 2 minus x sub 1 or the third term in the square brackets are changed, and also the first term in the square bracket changes into the second term. The second term changes into the first term. We can also see that the d value of d obtained with the symmetric space eigen function is different from the value obtained with the antisymmetric space eigen function because of the difference of the sign of the third term in the square bracket. In other words, the average separation between the particles in the state in which the space eigen function is symmetric is different from what it is in a state in which the space eigen function is antisymmetric. The exclusion principle. As a result of an analysis of data concerning the energy levels of atoms, which we shall study soon, in 1925, Pauli was led to his famous exclusion principle, Weaker condition. In a multi-electron atom, there can never be more than one electron in the same quantum state. He then established from the analysis of other experimental data that the exclusion principle represents a property of electrons and not specifically of atoms. The exclusion principle operates in any system containing electrons. Now consider the antisymmetric total eigen function of Formula 9 for the case in which both particles are in the same space and spin quantum states alpha. It is T sub A equals 0, formula 14. The eigen function is identical equal to zero. Hence, if two particles are described by the antisymmetric total eigen function, they cannot both be in a state with the same space and spin quantum numbers. The eigen functions we have been dealing with were obtained under the assumption that there are two identical particles, that the interaction between them can be neglected. If there are more than two identical particles and or if their interactions must be taken into account, the total eigen function have different forms, as we shall see in examples 2 and 3, but they can still be used to make linear combinations of definite symmetry, either symmetric or antisymmetric, and the antisymmetric linear combinations still have values identically equal to zero if any two particles are in the same quantum state. In other words, all antisymmetric total eigen functions have properties which conform to the requirements of the exclusion principle. So we conclude there is an alternative expression of the exclusion principle, Strange condition. A system containing several electrons must be described by an antisymmetric total eigen function. The condition specified by the second statement of the exclusion principle is stronger than the condition specified by the first statement because it satisfied the conditions and it also satisfies the requirements of indistinguishability, which demand total eigen function of a definite symmetry. The stronger condition must be used in quantum mechanical calculations that aim for complete accuracy. But the Weaker conditions, which is much easy to apply, is often used in approximate calculations. In discovering the exclusion principle, Pauli found the answer to a long-standing problem concerning the structure of multi-electron atoms. He has written, "The question as to why all electrons for an atom in its ground state were not bound in the innermost shell had already been emphasized by Bohr as a fundamental problem in his early works. However, no convincing explanation of this phenomenon could be given on the basis of the classical mechanics. It made a strong impression on me that Bohr at that time and in later discussions was looking for a general explanation." Pauli's explanation of the problem was certainly general. All the electrons cannot be bound on the same quantum state represented by the innermost shell of the atom because the system must be described by antisymmetric total eigen functions, which vanish if even two electrons are in the same quantum state. If all the electrons in an atom were in the innermost shell, then the atom will be essentially like a noble gas. The atom will be inert and it will not combine with the other atoms to form molecules. If electrons did not obey the exclusion principle, this will be true of all atoms. Then the entire universe will be radically different. Example 2. Determine the form of the normalized antisymmetric total energy function for a system of three particles in which the interaction between the particles can be ignored. This is easy to do if it is noted that the two-particle antisymmetric total energy function P sub A equals formula can also be written as a so-called Slater determinant P sub A equals 1 divided square root from 2 factorial multiplied matrix, when 2 factorial equals 2 multiplied 1 equals 2. The identity of these two expressions can be verified by expanding the determinant. In determinantal form, the expansion of the three particles is obvious. C sub A equals 1 divided square root from 3 factorial multiplied matrix, where 3 factorial equals 3 multiplied 2 multiplied 1 equals 6. Expansion of this determinant wields C sub A equals next formula. Each term of this linear combination is a solution for the same total energy to the time-independent Schrödinger equation for a potential energy function in which the variables can be grouped into a sum of terms that each depend on the coordinates of only the one particle, as in formula 2. Therefore, the linear combination is also a solution. By exchanging the appropriate particle labels, as we did in formula 11 for a system of two particles, it is easy to verify that it is antisymmetric with respect to the exchange of any pair of labels. It also has the property of the being identically equal to zero if any two particles are in the two same space and spin quantum state. This can be seen most easily from the determinant itself, since it is a well-known property of determinants that they vanish if any two rows are identical. It is not difficult to follow the procedure of example 1 and to show that P sub A is normalized if P sub alpha from 1 multiplied P sub beta from 2, P sub gamma from 3, and similar terms are normalized. Is the case for electrons, the symmetry character of the other kinds of the particles is a question settled by experiment. It is found that the system of protons or neutrons or certain other particles must also be described by antisymmetric total energy functions. On the other hand, it is found that system of photons, helium atoms and certain other particles must be described by symmetric total energy functions. There are important phenomena associated with the symmetry character of the symmetric particles. The most spectacular example is the superfluid behavior of liquid helium at temperatures near absolute zero. Table 1 lists several kinds of the particles, their symmetry character, and also the value of the quantum numbers that specifies the magnitude of their spin angular momentum. Also indicated are the two names, fermion and boson. Sometimes users distinguish the two class of the particles according to their symmetric character. It is very interesting to note that there must be some connection between the symmetry character of a particle and its spin. The point is that all the antisymmetric particles have half-integral spin, just as the electron has, while all the symmetric particles have zero or integral spin. This connection has been studied by Pauli and others using very sophisticated forms of the quantum mechanics. Some understanding of its origin has been obtained, but It is appropriate to say that the symmetric character of a particle should be considered as a basic property, like mass, charge, and spin, which is determined by experiment. An exception of this statement is that the symmetry of the well-bound composite particle, like a helium atom, can be predicted immediately from the symmetries of its constituents. If the composite particle has an even number of antisymmetric constituents, it is symmetric. Example 3. Determine the form of the normalized symmetric total energy function for a system of three particles, in which the interaction between the particles can be ignored. An analogy of the relation between 8 and 9 formulas, the required energy function can be obtained immediately by writing the linear combination found in example 2, with all of the signs positive, that is, P sub A formula. It is immediately apparent that this linear combination is symmetric with respect to the exchange of any two particle labels. The normalization can be verified by the procedure used in example 1. Exchange forces and the helium atom. We turn now a property of the indistinguishable particles, which is, to say the least, very strange. Consider a pair of electrons in a system in which we can ignore any explicit interactions, like the Coulomb interaction, between the two particles. According to formula 9, the total energy function for the system can be written. Next formula. This antisymmetric total energy function depends on both the space variables and the spin variables of the two electrons, since the symbols alpha, beta, gamma, etc. specify sets of three space quantum numbers plus one spin quantum number. For the present discussion, we rewrite it in such a way that the space and spin variables occur in separate factors. It is total engine function equals space engine function multiplied spin engine function. We also make both factors have a definite symmetry with respect to exchange of the particle labels. Antisymmetry of the total energy function can then be obtained by multiplying a symmetric space energy function times an antisymmetric spin energy function, or by multiplying an antisymmetric space energy function times a symmetric spin energy function. The normalized symmetric and antisymmetric space energy functions have the forms we used in example 1. Symmetric space engine function, formula 15. Antisymmetric space engine function, formula 16. Where C sub A from 1 multiply P sub B from 2 and P sub B from 1 multiply P sub A from 2 are normalized. Each symbol from the series A, B, C, E represents a particular set of the three space quantum numbers only, in contrast to the alpha, beta, gamma, which represent sets of three space and one spin quantum number. There are three possible symmetric spin engine functions. Symmetric spin engine functions, three equations, three positions, triplet, formula 18. Their symmetry is obviously, since for each and each exchange of labels results into change into eigenfunction. Their three describe the so-called triplet states, and the antisymmetric engine function describes the so-called single state. All four of these spin engine functions are normalized. A physical interpretation of the singlet and triplet states can be obtained by evaluating for each state the magnitude S prime and Z component S prime sub Z of the total spin angular momentum S. This vector is equals E sub 1 vector plus E sub 2 vector, formula 19. The sum of the spin angular momenta of the two electrons. as is true for all angular momenta in quantum mechanics, S and S prime sub Z are quantized according to the relations. Formula 20. The quantum numbers satisfy the relations. Formula 21. The relations between the quantum numbers obtained when S and S prime sub Z are evaluated can be represented and explained by the rules of the vector addition used earlier. Figure 2 shows two vectors of length S equals 1/2 added to form a vector of length S prime equals 0 or 1, which can have, in the latter case, Z components of plus 1, 0, minus 1. Figure 2 vector diagrams representing the rules of for adding the quantum numbers S sub 1 equals 1/2 and S sub 2 equals 1/2 to obtain the possible values for the quantum numbers S prime and M prime sub Z sub S. As we have warned before, the vector addition diagrams must be interpreted cautiously since the vectors are not really angular momenta, but they do not convey correctly the impressions that in the three triplet states, which correspond to S prime equals 1, MS equals plus 1, S prime equals 1, M prime equals 0, S prime equals 1, M prime sub S equals minus 1. The electron spins are essentially parallel. In the single state, S prime 1 equals 0, MS sub S equals 0, the electron spins are essentially antiparallel. Figure 3 attempts to show the angular momenta, but as it cannot truly represent the linear combinations, formulas 17 and 18 is always simplifies somewhat. Now we shall employ these ideas to explain a fundamental property of a system containing two electrons. If the spins of the two electrons are parallel and the spin eigenfunction is one of the symmetric triplets of 18 formula, the space eigenfunction must be antisymmetric as in 16 formula in order to have the total eigenfunction antisymmetric. Figure 3, triple state,